Hey, welcome to the College of Complexes. My name's Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Lewis Silverstein, PhD, Distinguished Professor of Humanities at the HHSS Department, Columbia College in Chicago. He's going to be teaching on the subject, Teaching to Hearts and Minds. Now, Professor Silverstein states that his presentation will be drawn from the following words of Winston Churchill. As the technological capability of humans continues on its relentless march to who knows where, we must remember that there is a thin veil that separates civilized man from savage man. Unless there is as much effort, unless there's as much effort put into the cultivation of the teachings of the heart, compassion, mercy, and caring as there is into the cultivation of the mind, history teaches us that the human race is in store for barbaric tragedies on a scale that dwarfs the imagination. Now, a round of applause for our speaker, Lewis Silverstein.
I'm going to be talking about teaching to hearts and minds, okay? And let me say a few more things about myself. Right now, I am a distinguished professor of humanities at Columbia College, Chicago. I teach four classes. Studies, social problems in American society, education, culture, and death and dying. I've also taught at the high school level. I've taught at the junior high school level. I've taught at the elementary school level. I was the coordinator of an alternative school in Harlem, New York. I've also worked at the preschool level. So when I'm talking about teaching to hearts and minds, I'm really talking to people that go from very young till they're older. And as people get older, our hearts tend to close up. Our hearts tend to close up for a whole variety of reasons. So I want to start with a story. I think we all know that we're in the 21st century. We're sitting around here enjoying the fruits of human civilization in so many different ways. We don't have a CTA, we need a better one, but it does take us to incredible places. We do drive, we do fly. We can open people's bodies and do the most incredible things to people's bodies there. And yet, in this time, in the 20th century, more human beings have been killed than any other time in human history. And it would seem there was the belief system that as human beings develop their rational aspects, your ability to be logical, the ability to reason, your ability to think critically, if that developed, somehow we would move from barbarism, to civilization. Yeah. And there's a quote from Mahatma Gandhi when he was asked, "What do you think about Western civilization?" And we know that it's not that long ago. His response was, "I think it's a good idea. I think it's a good idea." So I think we need to redefine what we mean by civilization and what we mean by civilized. So the story, is in 1936, 35, something like that. I'm not yet born. I was born in 1940. And my mother is a Jewish immigrant from Poland. My father is a Jewish immigrant from Lithuania. And the war is over. It's 1945. The war is over. I'm a young child, 5 years old. And I want to see the soldiers come home from this incredible war against the Nazis. So my mother takes me to where there's going to be a parade. And I said to my mother, when I grow up, I want to be a man also. I want to be a man. And my idea of a man was that you become a soldier. You become tough, you become hard, you're a soldier. Either in battlefield or at home. And so I asked my mother to buy me a soldier's uniform. And as a child, she bought me for her child a soldier's uniform with a toy gun. And so I went to the parade for the soldiers coming home, and they had done, you know, incredible work. They were fighting the Nazis. The Nazis did have to be fought. And as the soldiers are marching by, and there's tremendous music, and people are clapping, and there's so much joy in the air, I turned to my mother, Yetta, and I said, "Mom, when I grow up, I want to be that." And she said to me, "Lewis, my son, I want to tell you a story. I was once a young girl. You know, it's hard to look. My mother then, I think, was in her 40s or 50s, I don't recall. She said, "I was once a young girl. I was once 10 years old. And I was babysitting, taking care of the child of another woman who was about 27 or 28 or 29 years old. And that day she was home also. And I don't remember, Lewis, my son, whether it was the Germans or the Polish or the Russians. All I know, in my village, soldiers would come in on a regular basis and terrorize us, totally terrorize us. But I can't remember. All I know is they looked alike. And although they wore different uniforms, what they looked like, they were all young men. They were all males. So, Lewis, I'm babysitting. I'm home, the child is home, it's about a two-year-old child, and the woman, the mother's home also. And as we're there, we hear footsteps coming up the stairs, and then there's banging on the door. And I don't remember, Lewis, whether it was German or Polish or Russian, whatever the case might be. You know, we didn't understand the language, although my mother spoke Polish, so it wasn't Polish. And she said, we could tell by the voice that this was a very powerful force. The door was being hit so hard that this was a very, very powerful force. And when the door was hit so hard, we knew it had to be the force of a young man. And since all of our young men were off fighting somewhere, we knew it was not someone from this village. And we learned when there were young men coming to this village, were not from this village, to stay away from them. They could not come bringing good tidings. And we didn't open the door. The banging got louder. We didn't open the door. We began to feel fearful of what? This force. The force of the young man. And finally, the door was crashed open with the rifle butt of this young man wearing a soldier's uniform. So was he a young man or was he a soldier? Did something happen to young men when they become soldiers? And I've been in the military too. You know, but I did seek release as a conscientious objector. And we cowered. We went towards the corner of the little apartment, and we cowered. And the young man, no, not the young man, the soldier, who was once a young man, came walking towards us. And he looked at me, and he looked at the baby, and he looked at the mother. And we could tell from his eyes that something had happened to this young man. Because if this young man were back home, and another young man was walking into his mother's house, with the look that this young man had on his face, the young man in the apartment with us would know that this man is crazy. Why is this young man causing so much fear to my mother? Why are you doing that? Get your senses together. Why are you doing that? And he walked towards the woman, and the woman knew what was going to happen. She was going to be raped. Of course, there had been a number of rapes in the village by young men. But they were no longer men. They were something else. And I ran to the window, this is Yetta speaking, I ran to the window, and was about to cry out. And this young man, no, the soldier, what is this? Young man, soldier, what is this? He took out his bayonet, put it across my throat, and made it clear to me that if I screamed out, he was going to cut the throat of a 10-year-old girl. Now again, if this young man were back home, and another young man, or soldier, whatever, I'm not demeaning soldiers, two of my brothers were in the military too. That was occurring in that man's house, he would say, "What is going on here? This is crazy. This is insane. What human being would do that to a 10-year-old girl?" And then he walked towards the woman again with the knowledge that there was going to be a rape. And so I picked up the baby, my mother told me. I picked up the baby and I ran towards the door. And this person took his bayonet and pushed it into the baby's head. and killed the baby. Now, who does that? What happened to this person? Again, if someone had done that to the child, you know, of his life, you would know that this person is totally insane, totally crazy. And he said, Mom, Yetta, what did this man look like? He looked like hardened as steel. His eyes were like steel. His heart was closed, because his heart were open. And he felt what he was going on, not just in his mind. If he felt what was going on, let the emotion in that room go into him, he could not have done what he did. He could not have done what he did. You know, so I go back to the words of that I was introduced by, if I can find them, I have to take my glasses off. Okay. Winston Churchill, Prime Minister of Great Britain. This is, you know, World War II, 48 million people killed by some of the great civilization on the planet, or technological civilization, I should say, on the planet Earth. And this is his words again. As the technological capability of humans continues on its relentless march to who knows where, we must remember that there is a thin veil that separates civilized man from savage man. Unless there is as much effort put into the cultivation of the teachings of the heart, compassion, mercy, and caring, as there is into the cultivation of the mind, history teaches us that the human race is in store for barbaric tragedies on a scale that dwarfs the imagination. Now, this is after the Holocaust. This is after World War II. I mean, what is going on with the human journey? Okay, so I want to stop now, and we're going to show you a, you're going to see, I'm not going to show it to you. You're going to see about an 8-minute video from a panel that I put together entitled The Language of War. The young man who you will see is a veteran from Iraq, went back, and then a veteran from Afghanistan. The other member on the panel is someone from Vietnam. But you're going to see Anthony, who is also my student. Okay, so let's just give our attention to him.
Children are out freely playing. The answer is obviously no. I came back from Iraq and had seen great suffering in Baghdad. And I was very screwed up. So, me and my old lady, we divorced. My wife, we divorced. We were both alcoholic. It didn't help that she drank too, but I have had so many problems. I would drive anybody to drink to live with me. And I got on drugs and all that. And I didn't know what to do with myself, so I went back into the Army, because it's all I knew. And so I became a, you know, this is another weird thing about language, although I was trying to change things to make it prettier. I was a healthcare specialist, which is actually combat medic. You know, they changed the name from combat medic to healthcare specialist. Oh, absurd. You know, all the good that could have ever been done in my mind in the country of Iraq, and certainly there are other veterans who aren't going to wear Iraq veterans against the war shirt, aren't going to join forces with us, aren't going to speak out in protest, aren't going to demonstrate, write their congressmen. There are other veterans out there who are locked into this, you know, mind state that it's a just cause. But, you know, all the good that ever could have been done in that country just won't bring back the nearly 1 million dead human beings, brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers. I mean, imagine if somebody came to our country and tried to do what we're doing in Iraq, Afghanistan, and elsewhere. I just can't seem to pull any good out of that warfare. And I really encourage people to, you know, not join the military and try to follow their avenues. I didn't know about federal student aid or anything like that. I was just totally ignorant. And I ended up in a psych ward while I was in the military that second time. I was having such problems with drugs, alcohol, PTSD symptoms. And so I spent like 7 days there. And as soon as I got out, I had verbally assaulted this first sergeant. And so I had to do a little time in the military jail there at Fort Sill for telling this first sergeant off. And I thought, wow, they see that I just got out of the hospital. And then they turn around, knowing I had problems, and put me in jail, okay? So, another thing I want to point out is just the amount of sexual harassment, sexual assault towards females in the military is disgusting. I see it every day, everywhere else anyways. But you think, in a disciplined place like the military, that it would be very hard for that to exist. No, it's not. In fact, it's so common and rampant that there's military jails packed with rapists and things of that nature. You know, I saw it today, actually. I was driving here on Roosevelt Road, and there was a guy calling from his car, shouting his phone number to a pretty black woman walking across the street. And I did comment to my brother and girlfriend were in the car. See, that's what I'm talking about. That's the society we live in, where that's appropriate. But definitely digressing there. You know, I hate to think that this is as far as we come in the evolutionary process. This is as far as we come that we can't figure out a way to oust a dictator or make change that is good without dropping bombs and deploying soldiers and occupying countries for imperialism and empire. They need men and women to pull those triggers, men and women to fly those jets. Without men and women to do so, I suppose we'd have to get a good robot thing going on. I don't know. Unless you think there's some, I'm messing that up. All right. Let's see. So, I speak in classrooms with We Are Not Your Soldiers. And if you have brothers or sisters or cousins or anybody that you know that's in high school and they have recruiters that prey on the kids there, you know, let we are not your soldiers know, contact us, and we can send out a veteran to a problem meeting, and some activists to talk about the facts, talk about the numbers, how many veterans commit suicide, how many veterans are homeless, how many sexual assaults happen. These are things that recruiters are not going to talk about. They're not going to talk about these things. They're not going to talk about civilian casualties and things of that nature. So let us know, we are not your soldiers, and we'll come to that high school and try to have a discussion, an open discussion, instead of the one-sided thing that they're getting from recruiters. Power to the people. Another catchphrase.
Trying to get it stopped.
Casualty.
Did you want to play it?
Is the word we use instead of...
Okay. Let's get your mic back up.
Okay, so you have just seen Anthony Wagner. Now, there are two Anthony Wagners. The young man who you saw here, that functions, and the young man who became, during his first tour in Iraq, a lot of alcohol, a lot of drugs, including a heroin addict. So we say there's two young men. So a man sort of has his act together, you know, his head is directing him. The alcohol, the heroin, is because he began to feel what he was doing. Okay, and you're not supposed to feel. As Anthony told you, he came out, he was still a heroin addict. He tried to get his act together, did as best he could, but he only knew the military, so they took him back in, even though he was an alcoholic and a heroin addict. And he returned from Afghanistan, still on, still his arm was all tracked up, came to Columbia College, had VA benefits, and decided that he was going to turn his life around. Studied film, and then decided to do journalism because he wanted to use film to tell the world what it is through his eyes there. He just saw Anthony. 2 days later, his mother called me to tell me Anthony has just killed himself.
Oh, no. Shit.
He could not deal with all the pain and feelings that he had. He could not deal. He said, when I was able to cut it out, I could function, but I couldn't cut it out. He said, my heart had been ripped open by my experiences, and I couldn't take this anymore. Holy fuck. You know, unfortunately, a lot of young men's hearts are not ripped open until they have experiences like this. And when I say teaching to hearts and minds, I have women in my class, and women can be, you know, messed up to and screwed up to, so on and so forth. But the truth is, when my students share with me about their life experiences, what they tell me is what they fear the most are the guys. One out of the four female students are raped in college and universities by educated, intelligent, you know, mindful young men from Harvard to the University of Illinois. When they talk about domestic abuse, it's mostly their father did it. And they'll tell the story about after domestic abuse occurs and the male is out of his craziness, he'll say, why did I do this? Because when he's out of his craziness, he's feeling what is going on. So what I try to do as part of my teaching, you know, as a teacher, I'm teaching critical and creative thinking, but I want people to really be in touch with their hearts too. So when they're about to engage in an act, they don't allow their rational mind. A lot of times a rational mind is a controlling thing. We learn to control, okay? Our mind separates us from relationship. But I want my young men as well as my young women to feel. So before they decide they're going to do something, they will feel what they're about to do. And in many cases, their heart will stop them from what their mind will tell them to do.
So just a couple more things, and I'm going to stop there. David Berrigan, I hope you all know who Daniel Berrigan is. We know that he passed last week. Bless his soul, you know. And I dropped out of my junior year of college in 1960-something to join the United States Army because where I came from, I'm a poor immigrant family. I wanted to see the world. I didn't have a car. I didn't know, so I just joined the Army. A few years later, while in the active reserve, I sought release as a conscientious objector. Because I began to feel, I had not been sent to war, but I began to feel what I was experiencing while as a soldier, and that got me into trouble. But after that, Vietnam War was on, but I didn't really pay that much attention until two things occurred, which is one is, I think, in 1967, both things occurred in 1967. I was teaching high school again. Ramparts magazine was a famous magazine at that point, and they had sent Dr. Benjamin Spock over to Vietnam to document what the war was really about. Okay, its effect beyond what we saw, in most conventional media. And Ramparts magazine published a special edition called The Children of Vietnam. And what you saw in that magazine were children whose faces were melted into their bodies, whose arms were stunted like that, who had no legs, their bodies completely burned over. And Spock said, I've used, and he's not demeaning the mind. He really thinks we need to think critically. But he said, somehow, all the words I've spoken has not really touched people until they saw these pictures. Then I had so much response, so many people writing to me saying, what is going on? I realized what had occurred. I went beyond their minds. Minds are important, but I got into their hearts. So I'm showing you this, this Ramparts magazine, Children. The first time I saw it, then I began to cry. And my students didn't know what to do with me, because teachers crying. Well, if we're showing horrible, horrible things, we should cry. Because we don't cry, we kind of tell people, that's not that important, it doesn't really matter all that much, it doesn't bother us all that much. So anyway, I'm teaching five classes, by the fifth class, and all of them are in the morning, by the fifth class, I'm watching children with no faces, children burned all over the place, and I'm eating my food while I'm watching this. And I said, oh my God, I'm teaching them. I just got affected tremendously. I became totally desensitized. Okay? And if we see enough war, even if you see enough anti-war stuff where, it shows the horrors and stuff which we need to see, after a while we become desensitized. It doesn't motivate us to any action whatsoever. 1967, going back to Daniel Berrigan, Daniel Berrigan in 67 prompted me to get active again in working against the war as well as other social justice things. So what Dan Berrigan did, Dan and Philip Berrigan with other, friends, both Jesuits, went to a selective service board in New York City, where I'm originally from, and they went in there. They took out selective service files into the streets there. They poured napalm on the files and then lit the files. And they said, you look at this selective service file, and what is it? What is it? And you read the words, but you're not told. What is it? It is a young man going to kill other young men. And how do I get people to see this file is torture? And after they did that, they cut their wrists, and they poured blood on the selective service files. Man, that blew the news media out of the place. Because it was no longer just words. It was words touched by the heart, which is the most effective teaching. So that caused me to move. Okay? And I heard lots of speeches again. Okay, so let me read these two things, and I'll say one other thing, then I'll stop there. This is, where is it? Bear with me a moment there. Thomas Merton, people know who Thomas Merton is? Anyone know who Thomas Merton is?
Yes.
Great, we got two people, that's great. Thomas Merton was a Trappist monk who was concerned with the state of the world, okay? And he used his meditation, he used his time to go within himself and educate himself in such a way that he would stay in contact with the world. And these are his words. One of the most disturbing facts that came out in the Eichmann trial, I'm assuming everyone knows who Eichmann is, most of my students know, was that a psychiatrist examined him and pronounced him perfectly sane.
Yeah.
Okay, a psychiatrist pronounced this man, who had played a major role in the deaths of 6 million, not Jews, 6 million fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters, children, lovers, parents. Okay? I do not doubt it at all, says Thomas Merton. And that is precisely why I find it disturbing. Okay, we'll just hold on for a minute. Someone's going to get it.
I believe I knew we'd get here.
It's okay.
It's okay, Robert. It's okay.
Everyone's showing. Okay, I'm going to go back. One of the most disturbing facts about the Eichmann trial was that a psychiatrist pronounced him perfectly sane. I do not doubt it at all. And that is precisely why I find it disturbing. The sanity of Eichmann is disturbing. We equate sanity with a sense of justice, with humaneness, with prudence, with the capacity to love and understand other people. We rely on the same people of the world to preserve it from barbarism, madness, and destruction. And now it begins to dawn on us that in fact, it is precisely the same ones who are the most dangerous. It is the same ones, the well-adapted ones, who can, without qualms and without nausea, aim the missiles and press the buttons that will initiate the great festival of destruction that they, the same ones, have prepared. We can no longer assume that because a man is sane, he is therefore in his right mind. And I'll go back again to Mahatma Gandhi. What do you think about civilization? I'm just holding on for a minute.
Yeah, let's get this guy
settled. Yeah, no problem.
Sorry.
No problem.
Nobody knows anything about far, but you
cause it.
I don't know
anything
about
it. We okay?
No.
No?
No, we're fine. We're fine. No, no. We're all brothers. It's me. All brothers.
Okay.
Okay.
No, just, okay.
No problem.
Go on.
Don't make a show.
It is precisely the same ones that are the most dangerous. It is the same ones, the well-adapted ones, who come without qualms and without nausea, aim the missiles and press the buttons that will initiate the great festival of destruction they, the same ones, have prepared. We can no longer assume that because a man is sane, rational, reasoned, logical, he is therefore in his right mind. That we are people of the mind, we're also people of the heart. And the same person feels and not just thinks. And now, the last thing I'm going to read is from a book titled The Things They Carry, okay, by Mr. Tim O'Brien. And Mr. Tim O'Brien, I don't know how many of you know the story, he was one of the best folks who came out of the Vietnam War. Tim O'Brien is about, I think, to go to Harvard or Yale, something like that. He's a privileged young man, and he's drafted, and he's thinking of going to Canada. And he's on a boat in rural Minnesota or something like that, thinking what he should do. And he's known a little bit what war's about, because, you know, he went to college, and he's read about World War I, he's read about World War II and the Korean War. You know, he's read about the great wars of, you know, ancient times and the War of the Roses that lasted 30 or 40 years, I think. He knows all this in his head. And so, should I go to Canada, or should I go into the military? And he makes this decision. He says, well, what will my buddies think about me if I run away to Canada?
Yeah.
Okay. Will they respect me? Will they think I'm a man? What will my father think about me? You know? What will my father think about me? It's okay. Let me go ahead. What will my father think about me? Will my father think I'm a man? I want my father to know that I am a man. I want my buddies to know that I am a man. I have one choice if I'm going to be respected by my buddies and my father. I have to go to war. Okay? I have to go to war. Okay? And I don't mean to offend anyone by this word. I don't want people to think of me as a pussy. which means soft, womanly. So these are his words. He was slim, he was dead, almost, he was a slim, dead, almost dainty young man of about 20. He lay with one leg beneath him, his jaw in his throat, his face neither expressive nor inexpressive. One eye was shut, the other was a star-shaped hole. A true war story is never moral. It does not instruct nor encourage virtue, nor suggest models of moral behavior, nor restrain men from doing the things that men have always done. If a war story seems normal, do not believe it. If at the end of a war story you feel uplifted, or if you feel that small bit of rectitude has been salvaged from the larger waste, then you have been made a victim of a very old and terrible lie. There is no rectitude whatsoever. There is no virtue in waging war. You can tell a true war story by its absolute and uncompromising allegiance to obscenity and evil. You probably read things like this when you were going through school. I read things like this when I was going through school. My students have read things like this numerous times. They've taken courses, you know, the Vietnam War and so on. And they did what you're supposed to do in school. You study something, and then you take a test on it, or you write a paper on it, or you do a project on it. You get a good grade on it, and then you move on. I don't think those folks who write war stories, or those folks who make films, you know, about it, those folks who write poetry about war, want that to occur. They don't want someone to get an A or a B. They're not opposed to an A and B. They want someone to carry what they just experienced with them. They want that person to feel what's going on. And that's why Mr. Tim O'Brien, when he wrote this book, said, I am after felt truth. Okay? I'm after felt truth. Okay? I want you to feel what's going on as well as know what's going on there. So what I do with my students after they read or see something like that, I tell them to be still, be quiet. I teach meditation too, I should say. Be still, be quiet. I want you to think about what you just saw. I want you to activate your minds to think about it. And now, I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to go into your heart, and I want you to feel what you just saw. And I want your heart to tell the rest of us, as well as the mind, what did you just see? I've been doing that for a number of years. My students, you know, still get very good grades. I'm considered one of the better teachers at UCLA. But more and more of my students have become activists because they have felt and not just known. They have allowed their gut to experience what they're seeing, reading. Okay? They're allowing their heart to experience what they're seeing and reading. So, and I want to make it clear, we need a just world, we need social justice, we need fair wages, we need housing for all, but we need to not just work on the exterior world, which has been part of my life journey, but also our interior world. Because we can have all the wonderful material objects in the world, and that just means we now create a super atomic bomb. Okay? Unless our knowledge is fused through our hearts as well as our mind, I do not believe we're going to have a very, very different world. Okay. So, let me stop.
Okay, now we're going to get into the question and answer session. How many people have a question? Everybody's got a question. Raise your hand. Okay, good. Now, I just want to remind everybody again that the questions must end with a question mark. It's time for questions, not speeches. Okay, Carl, you had your hand up. Go ahead.
How about drone warfare? Is that really going to maybe disconnect us further from the art of killing?
Question is, will drone warfare further disconnect us? Well, let me tell you about another 27-year-old man I had in my class last semester. Who spent time in Afghanistan. He comes into the class, and one of the things I do at the beginning of each of my classes, I have people go around the room and introduce themselves and tell the classmates something about themselves, because I'm trying to establish a community in the class too. It becomes his turn. And he says, look at me. Okay? Look at me. Who am I? And they don't know what, you know, what's he saying. You know who I am? I am you. I am you. I am you. I am you. And he's pointing to the men, and he's also pointing to the women too, because women can also now officially do what the guys have done. He says, you know who I am? I'm a guy who went to war, and I put on garb and went out into the countryside and met with people. And then when I came back, I put a tag on the people I thought were terrorists. I then got on my computer and ordered the drone to kill that person. Okay? Who am I? I am you. I'm higher, I am you. How'd you deal with this? No problem whatsoever. No problem whatsoever. Well, I take certain students out to lunch. I go, we should go out to lunch. You know, he's 27, he's a kid. He's drinking a lot of alcohol, folks. It can do that, okay, if you distance yourself, but he was somehow broke through. So my answer is yes. Okay, yes. I mean, if you see, you know, I had two young, well, my son's 26, my daughter's 33. You know, all the games, the video games, man, you rape, you fuck, kill, you cut off and stuff like that. And who's doing it? Not crazy psychopaths. And we know that, you know, we get... our minds get We know that there's more, you know, for many young kids right now, particularly, I have a male child, I love men. Their main educational source for sex is pornography. And a lot of the girls tell me, you know, the guys expect certain things from me because they think that's the norm because they've seen so much of this since they've been growing up. Okay? They become distant. You know, who am I doing this to? You know, who am I doing this to? So my answer is, yeah. Now, okay. I don't speak the truth. I don't know the truth. I just speak what I've learned over my 76 years on planet Earth. Okay, that's my version of sharing with you. So, you know, reflect upon this yourself and, you know, incorporate what I have to say into your own mix and you come together with what you think is truth.
All right. Gene, did you have a question?
Yeah.
Yes, Gene.
You mentioned a lot. You talked a lot about men and organizations dominated by men. In your experience, have you been a part of or know some organizations that are in fact dominated by women, and if you do, do they operate differently?
We are a patriarchy, okay? For many women who go into the world of organizations work, they have to prove themselves, okay? And the way they prove themselves in many ways is to adopt the rules of the masculine. They have to be tough, even tougher. They have to be harder, even harder. You know, they have to fire people and not care about the effects of that there. When we do have examples, though, of women who have not done that. We know in some of the Scandinavian countries, you know, when the women have been in control of government, it's not all women. Indira Gandhi was a real guy. She had big balls, Indira Gandhi, too. But women who are really in touch with themselves tend to create a more just society. They tend to spend less on, you know, military and more on social spending there. In elementary school, most of the teachers are women. You know, their relationship with their students tends to be more of a whole person. And as we go through school, you know, I was held by my teacher. I can't do that now because at times I needed to be held. My life, I had a difficult home. I needed to be held, you know. And I felt that. And as I went through school, mostly males, they wouldn't touch me. You know, I needed to be held, not just be told everything's going to be okay. Everything was not going to be okay because at that moment I wasn't feeling okay. So the answer is, if there's, each of us have the feminine and the masculine, okay, the yin and the yang. Our role is to balance the feminine and the masculine. And then hopefully we have a healthier society. Right now we are masculine dominated to the extreme. I do not hear, or I hear from my female children, not children, female students, I can do anything that a man can do. Okay? And we're being stereotypical. I hardly ever hear from a male student, unless they're gay, I can do anything a woman can do. I can nurse, I can take care of, I can nurture, I can be compassionate. So we have right now a masculine kind of funnel that even lots of women are going through. So the answer is, women who go through that, they won't be that different, but women who decide to stay more in touch with the feminine aspect, we have examples where they act very differently. You know, there.
Thank you.
All right. Sorry, did I interrupt
you? No, no, no. I'm talking too long.
Oh, yeah. All right. All right. Wesley.
Wesley.
Wesley's over there.
Yes,
Wesley,
you have
a question.
What would be your assessment of the current president in terms of the ideas you put forward?
He's out of touch in many cases. If he wanted to do something differently, I think he knew that virtually nothing would be accomplished. We can only, you know, judge a man by what he does there. I think to some degrees he's tried to be a little more humane, a little more just, but not very much there. He's Republican Congress, he's a black guy. The idea that a black man would be president of the United States drives lots of people crazy, no one in this room. So I think he realized that if he was going to get anything done, he had to kind of be not all that different, because I don't really see him all that different. Yet better than the guy he was running against. Okay, better than the guy he was running against. I'm also disappointed to some degree with the First Lady. My model of the First Lady is Eleanor Roosevelt. Okay? And anyone that doesn't come close to Eleanor Roosevelt, you know, at least they got to get a C. You know, but since Eleanor Roosevelt, I don't know anyone who's really assumed the mantle of First Lady in such a way, really took a job. So I'm disappointed with Michelle Obama, too. But again, you know, sometimes it's a world of lesser evils, and I prefer that, you know, this wonderful person there. So he gets about a C. Okay? Best as I can answer.
All right. Okay, Mike?
Yeah, I have a question, but in the interim, you said something that touched on me, and it's needing to be held. And the only time I ever called my teacher Mama was the day after JFK was assassinated, okay? And I needed to be held on that day. And what I wanted to say, I worked in my career for the U.S. Department of Labor, so I was in civilian employment, working for our great nation. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of people coming in from the military. Now, the people coming
okay,
in
excuse
from
me, Mike, I would just like to remind you that this is a time for questions.
Yeah,
for speeches.
There's a question.
I also just want to say further that we need to move things along, so that you need to, all of what you're saying would make a terrific rebuttal speech after Dr. Silverstein is
it's
finished.
It's a question.
Okay, so go ahead and ask your question, please.
Jeez.
I know. Tough guy, tough man.
Yeah. When we had people coming in from Vietnam, they were like, they didn't want to talk about Vietnam. When we had people coming in from the Middle East, they wanted to talk about it. You know, there was one guy who says, I wish they didn't put me on disability because I wanted to kill more Muslims. And there's a guy that's, he's got on his desk, and he still has it.
Okay, what's your question?
My question is, you know, the difference in the attitude from the Vietnam, people coming from Vietnam and people coming from the Middle East and their differences. And he's not going to let me, you know, fully elucidate the difference. But I wanted, you know, to get your perspective on that.
From the Vietnam veterans that I know, I don't see all that much difference between them and the guys who are coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan. Okay, I don't really see that much difference. Perhaps to some degree, what might account for a difference is that many, because of the events, Anthony said he was not a medic, but something else there. Many more guys are surviving, you know, grievous wounds to their body because of the technologies available right now. You know, we're, you know, you're right in the battlefront. You have your medical thing right there. Okay? Many of the guys who are coming back, gals who come here from Vietnam, would not have, I mean, from Iraq, would not have survived. So maybe to some degree, people who've been really grievously hurt, you know, that they might have a greater tendency, because they're in so much pain, to share. Okay? Most of these guys, from what my Vietnam vets tell me, they would have died. Okay, so maybe when you're really in pain, you begin to share to some great degree.
Okay, sir, did you have a question?
Yes, should Obama's Nobel Peace Prize be revoked?
The question is whether Barack Obama's Nobel Peace Prize should be revoked.
Well, it's a kind of a moot question. We're not going to do it. Should it be revoked in the... No.
Why? Why?
Why?
He's pursuing war, isn't he?
I don't think that's unusual, you know, that to some degree he's pursuing war. I think that he was he was given this award because maybe he realized to a greater degree the misgivings of war.
All right. Charlie, did you have a question?
Yes. Isn't it a little difficult to be teaching hearts and minds, actually, to some extent, anti-war, a K-12 setting? Because you might have some parents show up who's got a different value, set of values, right?
Yeah. Charles, I'm not telling people, just like I said to you, I am not someone who carries the truth with me, okay? I'm someone who's sharing my perspective on what I consider truth. When I'm teaching, I mean, they read both, you know? They read both, you know? I don't just share with them anti-war stuff. You know, I'll share with them the reading of a young man who's killed other people. Okay? And I ask them to be in that person's shoes too, so you can understand why a person does something like that and the forces that make a person do something like that. I'm not telling students they should believe this or not believe this. I'm also taking into effect, you know, students are social media from a very young age, okay? And most of the stuff they tune into, you know, in terms of, I think, a lot of things that you folks are concerned about, well, first of all, if they tune into it, they tend to focus on, you know, the action, the excitement, okay? They have a picture that war and stuff like this is kind of noble, so on and so forth there. So as a teacher right now, I've been teaching for 50 years. As a teacher right now, I realize that my students come in already with a lot of teaching. The primary teaching for young people now is not mother, father, or schools, it's the media. So they come in, and I see part of my role is to balance what they've gotten from the media, and if a parent comes to see me, and once in a while they have, I engage them in a discussion. I share that with them, like that. But I'm not trying to propagandize them, but they do know who I am. You know, they do know who I am. I've been called by parents for other things, more so than for this.
I just meant there's a lot of Trump-like parents, and, you know,
yeah,
out there, and they've got a different...
Yeah, they do. And my point of view is different from many of those people there. You know, so the challenge is, how do you, you know, it's easy to engage in a dialogue with people who agree with you. Okay? Part of the challenge of a teacher, part of myself, is to engage in a dialogue with people who don't agree with me. Okay, and to help some create an environment where they feel, to some degree, engaging in a dialogue with someone that they don't agree with. You know, and I try to soften up. You know, I'll start my conversation. You know, I'm a father too. I have children. I try to see some commonality, so they don't just see me as an object. You know, a foe. We're both parents. Let's talk about our kids. What kind of world do you want for your kids? So and so. So after I kind of soften them up, and I feel that we have some kind of connection, we can then get into harder conversations. Because at first, you know, what do we have in common? You know, what do we, you know, what do we have in common? So Charles, yes, okay, yes.
Okay, sir, did you have a question?
What about restoring the draft back again and sharing the responsibilities of all these?
Well, Doc, not Reverend, Adam Clayton Powell from Harlem, New York, introduced legislation some years ago to reintroduce the draft. Why did he introduce that legislation? He said, if we introduce the draft, many more people realize their asses can be busted off, their eyes can be blown away, their daughter, da, 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 da. And I'm introducing this as really a way to get people to realize what war's about and become more active. Of course, he was, you know, went nowhere. I think it would be a great idea.
Mm-hmm. Oh, excuse me, wasn't that Charles Rangel?
Charles Rangel. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Charles Rangel. Okay. Yeah, Charles Rangel.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bill, did you have a question?
Yeah.
Yes, Bill.
We'll be showing the film Hearts and Minds that was had some very great influence towards the end of the Vietnam War.
Did I see Hearts and Minds?
Is yeah.
It? Yes, I did see Hearts and Minds. I know.
Who are we showing it?
It said, did you say that we should be showing it?
Well, maybe we ought to show it here.
We ought to show it here at the college.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I don't know. What do you think about that idea?
Well, if you want to show it, I think it's absolutely fine. It's a long film.
It is. We haven't got enough time. We got.
Well, not today. We're not showing it.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah, but maybe another time.
Hearts and like, Minds is a powerful, powerful, powerful film. Yeah, about the Vietnam War. Another film I showed my classes is Regret to Inform. Okay? And Regret to Inform is a film made by a woman, really made by virtually all women. Her husband is killed in Vietnam. Okay? He's killed in Vietnam. And she's remarried, and she decides to go back to Vietnam to, you know, the place where her husband was killed, and to find, perhaps, who killed her husband. During her journey, she comes to this incredible realization, okay? My husband was killed because he did not kill other people, he murdered them. Okay?
All right.
He murdered them.
Sorry, my bad.
And then she goes and she meets the woman who led the North Vietnamese, but not battalion, group that killed her husband. Okay? And they sit down. And they share, because she lost her husband too, they share what they have in common. They share their hurt and their pain, okay? They hug each other, they cry with each other, okay? And they decide to work together to end the scourge of war. It's an incredible, and then if you look at that film, oh my God, you know, and what you also see, the music is like this. You know, most war films, you get all pumped up and all crazed, and you go out there. So you get so involved with the music there, you don't even see what's going on there. But this war film is almost like scored by classical music. It's like this, it's like a meditation, and you really get drawn into the movie there. And my students are impacted by that movie virtually in any other movie they've seen. And they've seen a lot of the Vietnam War movies there. It's very, 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 very
powerful. What was it called again?
Regret to Inform. It's on, I think it's on YouTube, it is on Netflix. It's an incredibly, it's a very different war film. Very, very different war film. Yeah. Any other questions?
All right. Does anybody else have a question? Oh, yes, Brian. Go ahead.
I can see. I'm sorry.
No, I normally, the moderator usually is the one that calls.
Yeah.
Go ahead,
Brian.
Since you're teaching, how do you teach people to follow their hearts? To open themselves to feeling, identifying with people they are possibly involved with, yeah, whether lethally or in any other way. I mean, social workers and medical people are told, yeah, to keep a professional distance.
Mm-hmm.
To dissociate. How do you get people to associate?
I hear you. We're told to keep a physical distance from our students, because you know a very small number of teachers, you know, have
publicity. You know, teachers are all rapists. They're all sexual. So we're supposed to keep a distance, you know. But we can, again, plug my language, we can fuck people's minds. Okay, you can get people's minds and really fuck their minds up. Okay, so we mean keeping a distance, we mean, you know, you keep here, right? You fuck your mind like crazy. And a lot of people's minds are fucked up. Okay, so having said that, you know, we really mean don't keep a distance. We mean we don't want people to really engage with what's going on because they might get out, as some of my students did in high school, after they saw the Vietnam War thing that we showed. They said, we're not going to any more class today. We're going out in the street and we're going to protest against the war. Okay? There. So what I do is do exercises in the class that allows young people to get in touch with their hearts. And it's everything from meditation. It's everything from meditation, which I do, you know, visualizations where they get in touch with their hearts there. Or we see or read something, and I ask them to see it through their hearts, you know, not just through their heads there. Students will tell me of someone who's doing some terrible things to them. And I say, no one is allowed to do terrible things to you, okay? You have every right to stop someone from doing terrible things to you. But I want you to look at that person and realize that person is doing terrible things to you, who wants a baby, who wants a child. And what happens? And a lot of times we're talking about their fathers or brothers or boyfriends. What happened to this beautiful young baby that this person now is doing these things to you? What pain causes someone to do these things to you? So I want you to look at this person and see that person as a child or as a baby, okay? And I want you to see him through your heart. Feel him through your heart. And I'm going to say another short story, and then stop when people come up there. And I'll give an example. My father, bless his soul, who had a very difficult childhood, he's a Jew in Lithuania. His father died when he was very young, and so on and so forth there. My father was a very difficult man, a very hurtful man. His kids lived in fear of him. And that's how I knew my father. And I didn't want him to come home, because we came home, we were all scared. And I remember one day, my older brother and I, my father was having one of his breakdowns, and my older brother and I was in our bedroom, and we both took knives out, and we wanted to go and kill our father. But we didn't do it, but we just stabbed in there, and I hated my father. My father is dying. This guy who was, you know, close to 6 feet tall is now 5'4" or 5'5". He's all shriveled up. He's totally defenseless. He's in a, you know, baby fetal position. I go in to see him. And I look at him and he says to me, Lewis, my son, do you love me? And in my head, I said to myself, no, how could you ask me if I loved you, given what you did to your children and your wife? How could you even ask me that? And then I looked at him and said, oh, this poor soul is dying, you know, I fell for him. I was not only, I fell for him in my heart, and then I said, boy, my father must have been really, really hurt as a child to do what he did. Really hurt as a child. And I realized that that person beneath that needed to be loved. Even if his last moment on planet Earth was an act of love. You know, because given my wife's belief system, we do believe people go on soul journeys, but that's a different topic. Yeah. And I wanted him to leave here in love, not in hate, so he wouldn't come back in hate. So I walked over to my father, and I said to my father, Dad, I love you. Not the man who hurt me, but the person that was in that person, who fathered me, brought money home sometimes to feed us, brought money home sometimes to pay the rent, so we weren't on the street all the time. And I tell that story to my students. Okay? I tell that story to my students. Yeah. You know, learn,
value critical and creative thinking, but value your emotional aspect, value your heart too, and experience the world with your mind, but also with your heart there. So anyway, I have students see their father, we do gestalt stuff, I have their students see their father or brother, and go through, I'm not doing therapy, folks, and go back there and experience that and see the person as once the child and tell the father that. You know, tell them what's the effect on you, because a lot of times people don't realize the effect they're having on other people. Okay, it's time for...
Okay, all right, wait, no, it isn't.
No, it's not, I'm sorry, I'm taking your...
All right, Dave, did you have a question?
Yes, I did.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Are you familiar with a movie called The Pawnbroker with Ross Niger?
Yes, I am. I've seen it a number of times.
Yes. As I recall, the film deals with a concentration camp survivor who also has to learn how to feel.
Yes. It's a very, again, the pawn, if you haven't seen it, with Rod Steiger, a great film. I think, who's in it with him?
What's it called?
Who's in with him?
What's the film called?
Pawnbroker.
I forgot who's in with him. It's a great, great, great film. Okay, with Rod Steiger, The Pawnbroker. The Pawnbroker. He's a pawnbroker.
Okay.
And who's with him? Was it Sidney Poitier?
Rod Steiger. There's someone else. Okay, who knows? I don't know.
All right, we got... Okay, Andy, do you have a question?
Who's Andy?
Andy's over here. Andy, go ahead.
I had one quick question. I didn't hear you mention it. There's Physicians for Social Responsibility, PSR, and a whole bunch of veterans groups are trying to teach that war is obsolete for handling. And given that the military now considers climate change and global warming to be the number one threat against America, how do you get this message across to young people that are thinking about going in the military, that they have to stop participating in the killing? That the U.S. military is recognized the largest killing machine on the planet. How do you get this message across to young people?
To get them to stop killing the earth?
The environment and people all over the world in these third world countries where our troops are killing people in Afghanistan, Iraq.
That's what I don't know when you came in, but that's what I think the bulk of my my presentation was about, how to get people to realize what the killing is all about, and then hopefully through realizing that and feeling that, fewer people will go into the military. In my peace studies class, we also have a section in my peace studies class on our relationship to the earth. Okay, and they read and they see films, but I also teach them to have experiences with the earth, the actual experience. There's a supposedly a DSM, if you're familiar with the field of psychology right now, called NDD, which is affecting lots of people. And NDD is nature deficit disorder. Nature deficit disorder. In the Native American tradition, any child who abandons his or her mother is a sick child. And the mother in the Native American tradition is the earth. And from that tradition, they feel that some of the reason we have so much mental stuff is that we're not in touch with our common mother, which is birth mother. So it's talking, seeing, but also experiential stuff.
All right. Sir, did you have a question?
Yeah, I wonder, since you're teaching in Minds and Hearts,
could you speak up, please?
I can't hear.
Do you think that in many cases it could be situational, like whoever volunteers to a concentration camp be a guard, or somebody who's been drafted, there is a big difference, and now you're going to be killed or killed. And the last thing is, do you take into account something like George Bundy and say, open your heart, or just sit down and shut up?
I'm trying to understand what the first part of the question was. Is that can be situational?
Yeah, right. Like, there is a concentration camp.
Yeah.
If I become a guard, I get some perks.
Yeah.
The war is hell.
Yeah.
So I'm, and for him to open up his heart might be a little bit difficult.
He would go crazy. He'd have to kill himself if he opened up his heart. The idea is, you don't become a god. you know, you don't, if you're going to become a god in concert or prison, you know, you're going to be doing things that you thought you would never do. So I think people need to know ahead of time, what is this thing called war? You know, what is this thing called, you know, internment camps? You know, what is this thing called prison? You know, most of my students, very few have been in prison. I take my students to the Cook County Jail. And I say, wait a minute now. I've been doing that for years and years and years. Who is in this jail? And who are the gods in this jail? What do they have in common? And what they tend to have in common is they come from, you know, lower immigrant backgrounds, so on and so. And then we talk about that and have a sense of what jail is about there, you know? So you get in a situation, sure, you're going to perhaps act in the ways, but try not to put yourself in that situation. This is where I repeat, it is not just in a work. We got to have a just world, a sane world. There are people that need to do the exterior work, and I value that. I've done some of that too. But people also need to do the interior work so we come together. Okay. And what was the second part of the question?
The second part were actually your draft. Okay, you did not proclaim an objector, being an objector. So, yeah. I mean, in this case, you either shoot or be shot, right? And so you don't have much choice there, right?
No, there are people that, look.
You cannot examine your heart in a situation like that.
I'm trying to think of, that's not necessarily true, and essentially, I'm trying to think, SLA Marshall. S.A. Marshall was one of the great military historians of all time, okay? After World War II, he was commissioned by United States, Army or Defense, you know, Defense Department, so on and so forth, to find out why so many American soldiers did not shoot their guns directly at the enemy, okay? Because they found, the truth is, a lot of American soldiers did not shoot, all we see is people shooting their guns. A lot of American soldiers did not shoot their guns at the enemy to kill. And S.A. Rush was commissioned to find out, wait a minute, how could this be? Why? And he said what the problem was is that the guys were too old. A lot of the guys were already fathers and so on and so forth there. And they were men, not just 18-year-old boys with testosterone that goes like crazy. So they asked them for a recommendation, if when the next war comes about, who do you want to fight the war? And they said 18 and 19-year-olds. Because 18 and 19-year-olds are fucking crazy. And they'll do crazy stuff. And the truth is, the Vietnam War was mostly younger men. The average age in World War II was like 26, 27. In Vietnam, it was like 18 or 19. So there were a lot of guys in the situation who could, I'm not saying it was right or wrong, I'm not judging them, who could not kill. Anthony could not shoot a woman at first. When he was ordered to shoot a woman, he could not do it because he said, as a good Christian, I cannot do that. Okay? After a while, he was able to do it, and then he started doing too much heroin, too much alcohol, so on and so forth. Okay.
Wait a second. We got to move on to other people.
Go ahead.
Okay. All right. Who else has a question? Does anybody else have a?
Anybody else?
All right. All right, buddy. What about Tim? You had your hand up.
I just wanted to figure. You know, you said we have to do the interior work. I found that, you know, going to like my normal church on a Sunday morning helps me deal with the interior work. I would like to know what your recommendations and how you would do your interior work, and you know, and as you put it.
How I've done it?
How you've done it and what you'd recommend to us who maybe are in similar, we've done things we regret and we want to do the interior work to find that heart that you talked about.
Hang around with other people who value that kind of work, okay? Hang around with other people. Find people who are doing that work in your community, in your church, whatever the case might be. And when I say in church, not just on Sunday. They do this work, they pray outside of Sunday, okay? They do other stuff out of Sunday, yeah. For me, most of my interior work has been three routes. One is therapy. Because I was so crazed for my father. You know, one of the things we learned, you know, Mr. Valcama, the actor, said, I didn't realize we'd taken so many things from our parents until we had children. And there were so many things I thought I would not do as a father that I found myself doing because that's all I knew.
So I had to go into therapy, okay? I needed, as the Beatles said, a little help my friends to get by. And I needed a professional because I had a lot of work to do, okay? I also learned meditation, okay? And I meditate, I teach people how to meditate. And then, and this I can't recommend to you, you know, because this is so, you know, individual. I am married to an angel from heaven, a goddess from above, you know, a brown-skinned woman from Puerto Rico, you know, who has held me to the toe about, Lewis, getting in touch with your heart, getting in touch with your higher self. She's been real tough on me, okay? And one of the reasons she's been real tough on me is that she loves me to the core. Okay, and that allowed me to open up and share things with her that I wouldn't share with other people because I was fearful they would leave, or they would judge me. So I can't recommend that you marry a brown-skinned Puerto Rican woman because that's an individual term. But I say hang around with people. I'm talking about, you know, the meditation stuff out of who you know, see films that open up, listen to music. Music's very powerful. Oh my God. I love to dance, I love trance, I love rock and roll, but I also listen to music that really touches my heart too. You know? So there are different ways to do it. Okay? Have a pet. Treat everybody like you treat your pets. Some of you don't abuse your pets. Love them, hug them, talk to them, forgive them. Now, pets are very powerful.
Anybody else have a question?
Let's move on to rebuttals.
Who has not already asked a question? No? Okay. There is
another question.
Okay.
I want a question from a woman. I think there are at least two in the room, because we had only the guys, and I love guys. I have a son, but I also have a daughter.
A liberal.
A liberal. No, I want a question from a woman. Come on.
He's a feminist.
Well, among a lot of guys, but speak out. Come on, speak out. Yeah, please. What's your name?
Karen.
I'm Lewis.
I do meditation also, and I appreciate your talk and your work. And we've talked in a group that I belong to about, is it going to change? Mm-hmm. And we have to reach people through things like meditation and interior work. But do you think that's really, well, not going to happen in my lifetime, I don't think. But do you think that we're on that way?
On the way to what?
To people becoming more internally aware and
my wife says, when I did yoga in the 1960s, people thought I was crazy. Now, virtually, yoga is everywhere. I think more and more people, especially younger folk, in some ways, are getting in touch with that. Whether we have enough time, I have no idea. You know, whether there's enough to turn the world around. As a father, that's what gives me tremendous pain. I mean, I've done my very best as a father to create a world for my children so when they grow up, the world is better for them than for me. I don't know if that's going to occur, okay? But you know what? You do what you do, not because of the outcome. You do what you do because you need to do it, okay? You don't know if you're gonna make it, but you do what you do because you need to do it. So that's my answer.
Let's get to the rebuttal.
Well, we got a few more minutes. Listen, I had a question. Okay. Now, first of all, I wanted to ask you. Now, I wanted to ask you, Lewis. Do you oppose all war?
Do I oppose?
Do you oppose all war?
No, I mean, no, I don't. I see war as a very last resort. There's no question, you know, that there are terrible, terrible people on this planet. I don't know if they're terrible people. People do terrible acts there. And that, at some cases, war needs to occur. You know, I'm a relatively peaceful person. If you attack my daughter, okay, I'll kill you. I'll kill them. Okay? But I'm going to do my very best to create a world where men don't have to attack, okay, my girl or someone else's girl. Okay? So the thing is, you know, wasn't the woman who, the young woman, what's her name, you know, who was from Pakistan, who had shot in the head because she was trying to go to school, she got the Nobel Peace Prize. Yeah, okay. When she met President Obama, she gave him some advice. She said, you know, you want to change, you know, that part of the world, then spend your money on education, not on war. You know, educate people, give them jobs, and then less people will go to war. Okay? And we know ISIS was paying $400 a month to the people. Now, there were crazy people in ISIS, no question about it. But the largest number of people, what they know, they were earning more money with ISIS than they could not be. There were not jobs for them. Okay? Now ISIS has cut down to $200 a month, and they're having some problem recruiting people. So, yeah, you know, ISIS, yeah. They're going to have to be killed, some, but hopefully you can create an environment where less people have to do that. So here's a step there.
Okay. Now, is there anybody else have questions? Okay, Charlie has his hand up. Go ahead, Charlie.
Yeah, isn't confrontation an inherent? Could someone tied into what our moderator asked?
What?
I mean, I'm a union organizer, and I don't want to do any harm,
yeah.
But I don't mind making life difficult for the CEO and the company on the right
hand. I agree.
Is that bad? Do I need
no, to I'm not people? Saying. But I think you can make life bad for him. I'd rather have people, I don't think, you know, people going to where the CEOs are, you know, and with their signs, with their bull and stuff like that, and telling people in that neighborhood stuff like what a son of a bitch that CEO is. You know, rather than going up to his door and just punching him, and then his neighbors will come to his defense. So you confront him in a way that there might be some change. I mean, I might want to punch him in the face, but I think it's more effective to get people in his community, get people in his community to know what this person is. And maybe because of pressure from his neighbors, that will add to pressure from the union. Charlie, my mother was a member of ILGWU. She was a floor leader of ILGWU. My father was a member of ILGWU. That's the International Lady Garment Workers Union. They confronted. Look, my mother was 4'4". Okay, we live in a slum building. The landlord at times would not give us heat and hot water. Okay, my mother thought that was terrible. You know, God should punish him. But in addition to God should punish him, she organized rent strikes in our building. Okay, we refused to pay the rent until that guy turned on the heat and hot water. So she said, "Guard," my brother Joe said, "That's how you do it. You know, why you lose, just go over and hit him. That's not going to do anything. You'll just call the police on you. You'll get arrested." Of course, that's the confrontation, but hopefully, it's confrontation that achieves your goals and doesn't work against your goals.
All right. Now, does anybody else have
We gotta go.
Okay, well, I don't see anybody else with their hand up. I estimated that we could do four more minutes, Tim, but... let's go on to rebuttal. Wait a minute, somebody's got their hand up. Sid, what is it? No, that's two. Okay, all right, let's go on to rebuttals. Okay, let's have a warm round of applause for Dr. Lewis. Okay. Lewis, did you want to take your papers, please? And listen, grab your phone. Okay, great. All right, now, we'll get on to the rebuttal period, folks. Now, first of all, what I would like from all of you is a show of hands. How many people would like to give a rebuttal speech? Okay, well, Bill is here leaning over my shoulder, so that's one. Two, three, keep your hands up, y'all. Four, yeah, that's right, y'all. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, and I'm 10, and our speaker is number 11.
4 minutes or less.
Okay, you say 4 minutes?
4 minutes or less. Yeah.
Okay, 4 minutes. Okay, Bill, you're up first.
We got a clock and we're going to run.
I had my one-on-one with the draft back in 68 and 69, and I wasn't really concerned with what anybody thought about it. To me, the Vietnam War was just a big, glorified expansion plan rampage, and I didn't want anything to do with it. It didn't matter. You go in the Army, they threw myself to military victory. It'd be murder in itself. I'd like to ask our speaker If you ever met John Cook at Professor Columbia, I haven't seen him in years. Well, I went to drop by Columbia a few years ago. Somebody should have talked to me about him.
Okay. As you notice, we came very late because my wife read me that thing at the thing, and I said, I gotta be there. I have a teacher at grammar school that used to grab me like this and carry me around, holding me. He knew I needed it. The brutality of the human being against the environment, against other people, against the animals, is beyond whatever anybody could honestly explain without crying. The latest thing that is happening to our sea is that because of the little bit of change in temperature in the surface of the sea, and an unintended or an unexpected consequences is that the water couldn't absorb the oxygen that is needed for all the animals in the sea to breathe. So we are in the process of ultimately killing not only life on the earth, but also on the sea. The sea without oxygen is a dead cesspool. We are going toward total disaster. And we don't have the capacity, we don't have the hearts and the minds to change that. We continue using our aggressive behavior against each other, against the life around us, without any kind of future. I don't see the change. I don't see how we are going to change that. Many years ago, I used to be a scuba diver, and every time that you go in the sea, you see plastic shit. You know me long enough that everybody called me plastic shit, because every time I see the plastic shit, 2,500 tons of plastic shit enters the sea every day. A billion tons a year is changing the life in the sea, changing the chemistry in the sea. The interaction between the plastic and the ultraviolet of the sun is creating hormonal mimics that changing the life and the species in the sea. This is a disaster that we are creating that have no way of describing it more than saying it's a fucking brutality. I have other things that I want. I came here because of you. I want to keep in touch with you. You touch many things. How we were treated as children, how we behave afterwards. I have a bad father and grandfather and so on, but my son, one of the things that I feel very proud, we are eating at the table and the kid, he hit with his hand a glass of milk, spilled on the table, and the first thing he did, he grabbed it and started pouring it out. He didn't go like I did, oh, because I was going to receive a big whack in the head. So I was able to control that bad influence from my parents, from my father especially, and I felt very proud. However, I don't think that my son have absorbed that hard, because he sees things more on the, if you are you know, in a bad position because you did it, he doesn't see the connection between what the world is doing to each other. The brutality of men against women, not only in Spain, but in Argentina, where I come from, where men put alcohol into women and light it up.
Brief reminder, please speak into the microphone.
We talk about civilization as the highest form of society. But actually, what is civilization? We went through slavery during Roman and the Grecian period. We went to feudalism after the Romans were conquered by the German tribes, and feudalism in England, feudalism all over Europe, and we call that civilization. Also, after the American Revolution, people said, well, we got a higher form society, but it's still civilization, a higher form of civilization. But what is civilization? Civilization is a number of people ruling over you, not you ruling yourselves. And when they do that, they exploit you. They go to war for profits. They ruin the environment, as we could see, as far as him talking about the oceans and the loss of oxygen and things of that nature. So we've come to a point where civilization has to be thrown in the dustbin of history. And we have to start ruling ourselves. In other words, people take a part in ruling ourselves and doing the functions of so-called government, which won't be government at all. It'll be just people controlling things and using rational means to develop things and not deal with wars to get more profit, greed, and so forth and so on. And when you have civilization, what do you have? You have a distorted consciousness.
You're welcome.
A consciousness that breeds greed. A consciousness that says, I have to make it on my own. I'm the keeper on my own. And therefore, I'm not interested in what other people do or what other people try to do, because I have to make it first, instead of cooperation. You have cooperation, people are thinking of each other, not of their own lust for greed. And this is a hard concept, but it's something that has to be developed in order to have a different and higher forms of consciousness where we're thinking of each other. And you can't just say, I'm going to have a certain type of life that is in contradiction to what you want to achieve, and then go in your room and meditate, or then go to a yoga class, or then get together and say, how do we change each other's minds? Your mind will be automatically changed if you change your environment. That's the important thing.
Okay, Brahm.
Well, I'm Brahm Basford.
Speaking to the mic, Brahm.
Oh, Basford. And I'm Amy from Brooklyn. So,
Brahm, can you speak into the mic, please?
Vote for Bernie from Brooklyn. And I was the secretary of the Socialist Party of Brooklyn, the branch of the Socialist Party USA, which still exists, although it may not get as many votes as some other socialist groupings. Right, but it might get more. Depends on how you organize. Anyway, that's aside from when I grew up. I grew up in Yorkville, Manhattan. I was the kids on my block. Well, some were Russian, some were German, some were Italian. These were enemy countries in one way or another. The Russians were on our side. Stalin was Uncle Joe or Papa Joe. Yeah, that was World War II. One of my friends, Hans von Steiger, he was a Swiss. His grandfather was, at that time, the president of the Presidential Council of Switzerland, and he was not allowed to play with the kids on his block. Why? He lived on the next block. I was an 89th Street kid. He was an 88th Street kid. On the 88th Street, they were mostly German. And some of them were pro-Nazi. You know, why? Because they knew that other people were out to get them. The Germans had suffered after World War II from the results of the Treaty of Versailles.
World War One.
Yeah, World War One. They were the losing side, and they had to pay in many ways. My parents were. They would go around at night. We would have air raids, and they were air raid wardens. Not that we got bombed that much, but there were German U-boats out there sinking ships, and there were always threats. And of course, we had to be inspired to defend ourselves and realize that there was an enemy out there that had to be fought, and we had to make sacrifices for the war effort. So there were blackouts, and some of the neighbors on the next block would not turn out their lights at night. Oh, anyway, what? I was brought up
in
a war mind. What is it that makes a peace mind? Well, there was Christianity.
Time's up.
Time's up, Brahm.
What is it? He's got 30.
No, it's 4 minutes each.
Okay, four.
Well,
yeah, 4 minutes.
Jesus taught people. To cast out demons.
Right.
To heal the sick.
Okay.
To raise the dead.
What about
if you're engaged in those sort of
things? Wait, Brahm. What about the other speakers?
You can see.
Okay.
What is needed?
Okay. Who's next?
Okay, I wanted to say something, but I want to say a couple of things. Sid is talking about being cooperative, and I went to Cuba in 2003, and I talked to people there, and most of the people were very happy just living as they were, but there were some people that weren't so happy. And I talking to them and getting their evaluations of what they were saying, I thought maybe there's different kinds of people in the world. There's a kind of person who's happy just living as well as anyone else, and then there's a kind of person that wants to live better than other people. And the people that in Cuba that were happy to stay there, they were happy just to live. They were happy just to live as well as anyone else. And the people that wanted to leave Cuba were people that wanted to live better than anyone else. They thought they were better than other people. Okay? And about what Prof said, that reminded me of Stiller and Mara. And they meet each other in this skit, and they discover they're from the same street. And he says, oh, you live on the same street? Do you know the Goldbergs? And she says, no. Do you know the O'Haras? And he says, no. Do you know the Silversteins? And she says, no. Do you know the O'Shaughnessys? And he says, no. And they say, what a small world. Okay? And But what I wanted to say about your thing is, of course, our motivation is love. It's heart. You know, we're in this because of love and heart. And that's why we love all each everyone on this planet. That's why we want to have a worldwide brotherhood and sisterhood, is from love and from heart. You know, there's a thing, you know, when a fascist comes up and wants to put you in a train car to Treblinka, okay, you can't convince them, to let you go because of heart. You know, you have to get down as bad as your enemy, and you got to fight them on the same basis. And so this heart, I mean, this, and okay, about the military, okay, yeah, in a perfect world, we don't need a military. We don't need our young people to go into the military. Okay, in a perfect world. In today's world, it's not such a perfect world, okay? In today's world, and I'm talking from working people, and I got sons, and I got a nephew, and, you know, and they're in the JROTC and everything. And of course, I encourage that, because in today's world, in this country, military equals employment, okay? We have a very high unemployment rate among young adults. Without the military, the unemployment rate would be sky high. And that is an alternative. And when a person talks about that, like saying, oh, yeah, you know, that's for nothing, and no, it doesn't take into account the realities, the economic realities that us working people face. And I have four uncles that served, and I served in a civilian capacity, and I served with people that served in a military capacity, and it's very naive to say that people shouldn't go into the military in our current world, because what else are we going to have? Us working people, okay? You want us to be employed elsewhere? Okay, give us a job, okay? You give us a job, you hire us. And, but otherwise, we're gonna go into the military.
I mean it! 4 minutes.
So, guy in another country just gave the same speech.
My name is Patel. I do not think that monotheism and universal love are compatible. So, we can talk about heart and love. No, it doesn't work that way. Mind doesn't work that way. Our mind is more cultural. It's a synthesis of everything. And we react to our general frame of mind. I'll give you an example. Last Thursday, there was an election in London for the mayor's office. And it so happened that one candidate was a Jewish candidate, Goldsmith. Very well-mannered. Very likable guy, and wonderful. Right. And we could not have thought that he can do anything. He can run campaign very nicely. Another guy was a young man from with Pakistani heritage, a Muslim man, and I beg forward and say something. The Prime Minister of UK. I'll connect everything. Prime Minister of UK commented on Donald Trump for Muslims not being allowed in USA. And he said that is a wrong policy, I cannot support Donald Trump. So I mean, he's on it there. And do you know what he did? In a mayor election, he sent out a flyers and an email to the Indian people that Muslims are bad for, Muslim mayor will be bad for you. Jewish candidate send out email that this guy to terrorist connection. Now, there is very interesting thing about that Jewish man. His sister is married to one of the famous Pakistani guy. And she wrote to him that, you know, that my brother is crazy. Okay? But see how things, how people, Prime Minister of UK, to change the people, repudiate so much. I mean, his heart was right first. What he believed is right. But what he practiced didn't come out right. And probably he did not think about that. And this is how heart and mind works. It just you think one thing, but you do something else. You know, you want to love, but you end up hating. Okay? And I don't know how to change. They have done lots of study of the mind. But we haven't found a formula that what we think in this kind of forum, and then we'll practice that thing. Because practicing is a culture. You cannot flip like this. You got to have very deliberate way to decide. Gandhi, during all his struggle, every time he had to make a decision, he just slowed down, thought, what is immoral. He had to think himself sure that I'm taking a decision, moral decision I'm making. Okay? It wasn't automatic, it wasn't spontaneous. And this is reality. And I don't think there are simple solutions, but culture, we can change. Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to recommend two books. I've recommended them before. The Chalice and the Blade by Ryan Eisler, and A Force More Powerful by Ackerman and Duval. Two issues here. One is nonviolent resistance, and the other is feminine masculine. Yeah, I know about Hillary Clinton. Yeah, I know about I know about Maggie Thatcher and Golda Meir. Sure, I know about all those people. But generally speaking, we need more women in power. You know, there's a masculine audience. I know there are exceptions. But I've learned a lot, and I've learned it mainly from the grassroots, but occasionally from books. Okay, this morning, what was I doing from 9 to 11? Maybe some of you were sleeping. I was in preparation for and learning about civil disobedience. This is something you might want to study. Again, that book, A Force More Powerful, Ackerman, Duval. You don't have to read the whole book. It tells a story. So, and I'm also in organizations. Organizations, various ones. I've been in masculine organizations and feminist organizations. And I seem to be doing better in the feminist organizations. The Second Unitarian Church of Chicago, Unitarian Universalist Association. I have over half of our ministers are women. And Jane Addams Senior Caucus, about two-thirds of our members are women, for a good reason. The men have died. But the ones that are left, some of us are learning. So thank you.
Can you turn that around so I can see it? You can watch the
So, but it takes me a long time to turn it around to set it.
You turned it around to where it was facing us in a half a second, so why don't you turn it back around?
All right, I will if you promise not to go.
The people who were in the pawnbroker, because I looked it up, Rod Steiger, and I haven't heard of most of them, Geraldine Fitzgerald, Brock Peters, Jaime Sanchez, who played the drug addict, Krishna Kaur Lhasa, all these people I never heard of, Linda Geiser, Baruch Lumet, and Juan Hernandez, and there was a walk-on thing with Morgan Freeman, which was probably one of his first acts. I would like to talk about the schools, and it actually relates. The school, I see public schools as a moral and social responsibility of a democracy to provide public education for their children. And I think that we're failing it when we corporatize and privatize schools and don't put money where actually people can use it. We're corporatizing everything and privatizing everything in our lives in this country. And we put profits before people, we put profits before the earth, we put profits before the environment. We're destroying the environment for profit. And there's just no thought about it at all. One of the things that can happen in the school and is happening in schools that are able to do it in primary and secondary schools is teaching of empathy. They have things they call peace circles or conflict. They're all ways of doing conflict resolution, where people sit down and have to listen to each other and put themselves in the other person's place as children. And so you're not socially as developed as adults are, usually. But you can still get into this, putting yourself in the other person's place. And we're able to teach children empathy, particularly if they are not learning it in their own home environments. And when we cut funds to schools, when we make it possible for sociopaths, in my opinion, like Emmanuel and Rahner, to cut funds to schools, then we impede that progress. We impede the progress of our society. We impede the progress of our city to develop into a real participatory democracy with people who are educated so they can participate as citizens.
My name is Dennis Nelson. Thanks, Dr. Silverstein, for a great presentation. Of course, Dr. Silverstein's main topic focused upon war and peace, but I took his primary topic and put together some notes which expand upon it and cover some other issues which I still see as relevant. In fact, these were generally brought up in the question and answer period. First off, we must become better people with improved social awareness and social skills. Antisocial behavior and actions must be wiped out at every opportunity, whether it is illegally dumping toxic chemical wastes along a deserted road or in a stream at night, illegally poaching rhinos in Africa for their horns and elephants in Africa for their ivory tusks, the federal government suppressing information about serious and unresolved nuclear reactor safety problems, intimidating and even murdering equal justice activists in developing countries who are fighting unneeded and destructive large dam projects and palm oil plantations, human trafficking during the Super Bowl, the harassment and assault of stand-up comics in Chicago's comedy scene, sexual assaults on our university and college campuses by some of the fraternities. Dr. Silverstein mentioned this in his presentation. Went on to point out sexual assaults in the military as well. We also have the leader of North Korea misusing and abusing teenage girls as sex slaves, Wall Street greed and corporate malfeasance, and even gun violence on Chicago's South Side that kills innocent kids. Bad manners should also be challenged at every opportunity and replaced with common courtesy and respect. I'm going to continue on with my primary interest in it, saving planet Earth and promoting ecological health and environmental quality. For the last 2 weeks here, you've heard me speak about the policies and technologies necessary to promote true sustainability. One of the resource books that I used in my presentation extravaganza 2 weeks ago about the contrasting and conflicting ecological worldviews of neo-Malthusianism and cornucopianism is There Still Is Time to Look at the Big Picture and Act, 2015. It is co-authored by Peter Sedell, who is an architect and urban planner interested in environmentally and socially sustainable communities, as I also am as an energy environmental researcher, a writer, and speaker. at the very beginning, he has a pertinent quote from Dr. Edward O. Wilson, a prominent conservation and evolutionary biologist, quote, "We have created a Star Wars civilization with Stone Age emotions, medieval institutions, and godlike technology," unquote. Providing his wisdom and insights, Peter Saddell philosophizes about what kind of people we need to become in order to live safely in this new world that we've created. This is Mr. Saddell's main message, quote, "Recognize that we are now on a path leading to catastrophe," unquote, "but there is still time to change our course." Quote, "Understand and accept what we really are. Recognize that our minds evolved to live sustainably as hunters-gatherers, but not in the world we now have. Become more than what we are. See the world as a unified whole and interact with it as such, holistically. Find more effective ways to reach others and convince them of our predicament. Work together. By working together, environmentalists and environmental organizations can develop new techniques to move beyond their current stalemate and make real progress towards sustainability."
Yeah.
And I've got some time left, and I would like to basically cover about what are the humanities meant for my own personal life. A background in the humanities is essential for a well-rounded education. I graduated from Dana College, a smaller four-year private liberal arts school in Blair, Nebraska, which had its own humanities department. Three semesters of humanities were required for graduation, one in my freshman year and two in my sophomore year. And I found the classes to be interesting and useful. I also took the advanced seminar in humanities for one semester in my senior year. The historical period that I studied was the Renaissance, and my presentation was about Leonardo da Vinci, Renaissance man of science.
Dennis,
thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Next.
Don't worry about it.
Okay, next. Lee Payne.
Yes.
4 minutes, Lee.
Okay.
Army or worse than you?
Yeah.
And that's saying a lot.
Thank you for today's talk, and I appreciate your heart and the feeling and mind, and to make people can calm down and think reasonably. I'm kind of person, I'm just try to think only logically like a machine. So I don't listen music, I don't watch art things, and I don't care what I dress, and my wife always complain that. So I think clothes just, it can fit me, that's good enough.
That's a joke, right?
Hey, well, one at a time.
Okay. Okay. About 4 years ago, I gave a talk in this college of complexes. I said the world is getting more peaceful, and then later I saw a TED conference, a TED talk, and there's a Professor Pinker from Harvard University. He did lots of statistic analysis, collect all the information, and visit all the tribe in the forest, in the tropic areas. And he concluded the people are getting more and more peaceful through the history, no matter it's thousands of years or tens of thousands of years or hundreds of years or tens of years. In different scale, he always proved people being killed by people is less and less. So, like most notably, is human rights. Probably more than 50 years ago, nobody talked about human rights. Human doesn't have rights, but now everybody talks about human rights. But the problem is the war is still with the technology improvement, war is between killing more skillfully, and then it's a very bad impact. So what we should try to do is try to let the people know war is not like the war 100 years or thousands of years. At that time, there's no journalist and no picture. So killing is killing, got killed and nobody sees that. And then the picture won't spread around. But now with technology, the journalists can write articles, can take pictures of movies, even everybody with a cell phone can take movies. So any violence will be reported and becomes less and less useful. So war is, I think, basically is a lose most of its usefulness after World War II. If you look at the Vietnam War, Iraq War, Afghanistan War against U.S. and Soviet, and although the superpower has a super military, but they all lost in the war. So I think the thing is technology give you better communication tools, like newspaper and the TV, and then people realize war is bad. And now internet can communicate people with much better capabilities. So I hope that everybody will change the mindset, war is useless, and the peaceful age is coming. Thank you.
All right.
All right.
Come up there and talk.
Yeah. Oh, Andy, whenever you're ready.
All right, let Andy talk. Come on, go ahead, Andy.
Hi, my name is Andy Anderson. I'm from the Northwest Information Service in Palatine, and I've given a couple talks here for the last 9 years on blacked out subjects, things the media don't report, how the American media functions. On July 9th, I'm giving a presentation specifically about how the media maintains Americans, you know, bubble of ignorance, believing things that are not real. Americans believe things that aren't real for a simple person. Hello, are you guys okay over there?
Guys, you gotta keep it down. Keep it down. Let Andy talk.
Our speaker tonight gave a tremendous presentation on, I think, one of the concepts is dealing with the reality of war versus picturing it like a video game. He asked, you know, how does this boy change from someone who would never do something like that in his own house to working in the house of somebody else and becoming a killer or a rapist? Well, it's been said many times, you can't have a draft where you draft 30-year-old men or 35-year-old men. They will say, fuck this, I'm not going to be a killer, find somebody else. Do you have to draft young men who are not old enough to defend their conscious minds yet, to turn them into killers? That's why we have recruiters down in the schools lying their ass off, presenting the military as something that's fighting for freedom, justice, and foreign lands. In this country, people with certain kinds of insane beliefs can get to rise up and be top officials. Give you some brief dates. In 1967, the people that gave us the nuclear power industry thought that we would, as a public, we would absorb one Chernobyl per year on American soil in exchange for cheap electricity for the rest of the survivors. One blast a year and a few thousand dead is not a big price to pay. The rest of us say that's clearly insane. 1975, same people in the nuclear power industry thought that we won't tell the American people about the hunt for nuclear terrorist bombs in American cities until we lose a chunk of the city. Then we have to admit there's a teensy problem with the whole nuclear power industry, because that's where bomb material comes from. 1983, T.K. Jones is flying around the country teaching businessmen that there's no problem with nuclear war as long as every American has his own shovel and can dig his own foxhole. These are people in the highest levels of our government. What he called, for was it Eichmann, World War II? He was listed as being completely sane. But they produced some really insane large crimes against humanity. Somebody, I forget who it was, that said those, the famous quote, those who cannot learn from history are doomed to repeat it.
Santayana.
Santayana. How many people? How many people have seen the wake-up call or know what the name of the ship? The Crystal Serenity. Does that ring a bell? It's a cruise ship. Crystal Serenity is listed in, on Truthout. One of the best websites is called Truthout. Has tons of environmental articles. DAR, D-A-R, Jamail, is producing these weekly updates on the crisis of global warming. The Crystal Serenity is a cruise ship that's going to charge $100,000 a head for the maiden voyage from the Atlantic Pacific through the Northwest Passage, where there used to be summer ice up in the North Pole in that area. So 63%, one final thing, 63% of all the carbon we put in the air has come in the last 25 years. The U.S. military says that is the number one crisis facing America now. Thank you.
Okay.
Charlie.
All right, settle down now, Don. Settle down.
Yeah, really.
Take it easy.
Exactly.
First of all, let's thank our speaker.
Yeah.
For a very nice presentation. Thank you for what you're trying to do in the classroom. Besides two quizzes and a term paper approach to pedagogy. I'll be eclectic as usual here. We seem to have drifted off into this war, non-war argument. If you want to go to war, there's certain things you have to do. First of all, you got to marginalize the enemy. And you've got to, you've got to make them dangerous. That's the first criteria. I've seen this, and I've heard this come out of the Pentagon, that there are these nefarious enemies, and this terrorism, and we see this in presidential politics, where tragically, a large segment of the community, of the people in the United States, are beginning to believe this type of propaganda, this marginalizing an ethnic group. We've got to bring an end to this. That's unhealthy and it's inaccurate, totally inaccurate. The other thing you have to do, and you got to get into to advance this war concept, is every action is defensive. I've told you this many times. It's been historically researched, and every mobilization of the Roman army, these are the Romans over 500 years. If you read the transcripts in the Senate, each of these were voted upon and were determined to be necessary defensive actions to defend Rome. Right. So watch out, anybody tells you that we are under attack and we've got to do this and to protect the homeland. That's ridiculous. Now, this last thing about joining the army because I can't find a job.
What?
Now, that's the strangest thing I've ever heard in a long time. When I moved back to Chicago in the late 70s, I did not have a job. Plus, I didn't have many prospects for jobs. There was a lot of jobs in my profession at the time. But at no time I was thinking about it, I ever considered joining the army.
Are you talking to me?
I don't care how long I was unemployed.
Are you talking to me?
I was not going to join the army. Now let me tell you about the United States Army. And I tell this time many times again, I'm going to tell it again. In Plato's Republic, you had people that get three categories of individuals in the Republic. Now, some people are philosopher poets, which you can ascribe to. I think that's one that's kind of worthwhile, you know. People that kind of like think, you know. And then in the middle, he had what, like merchants and manufacturers. And these are people, materialists, and they kind of like stuff. So if they like stuff, they might as well make the stuff. And if they'd be happy, since they like stuff, they might as well make stuff. But the third category he had were kind of these aggressive people he didn't know what to do with. So he said, we'll put them in the army. And they'll protect the city-state of Greece. But anyhow, thank you very much. Please come again when you got another one. gave us a lot to talk about here. And all right, good to see you again. Thank you.
We're out of time.
I'm going to be real brief. First of all, I just wanted to. I'd like to also thank our speaker for coming tonight and giving a really good presentation. Very good speech. Now, second thing I would just like to say. I would like to ask that all of you be nice to the waitress. Now we only got the restaurant only gives us one waitress to serve everybody here in this section of the restaurant. That's a lot of work. Now I'm not pointing any fingers at anybody, but some people have been rude to the waitress and treated her badly, and I would just like and so I'd say that you got to treat the waitress the way you would want to be treated if you were in her place. Now the second thing I think, Tim, could you point the okay? You know what?
You've got Don. It's 8:45 now.
Okay. All right. All right, I'll just use my own watch. Okay, now, I asked our speaker tonight if he opposed all war, and he said no. And I do think that there are some circumstances where war is justified. But in this country, you know, we're used to war always being something we choose to do or not to do, because that's how it's been for us for 70 years. You know, we can either go into this war or not, you know. And so we've never in the history of the United States have we ever been occupied like a lot of countries in Europe were during World War II. So we naturally tend to view war as something that we choose to get into, and then we go invade and conquer another country and commit all kinds of atrocities against its people, because that's how it's been for most of American history for us. I do think that in this country that I think the balance is kind of off, and that our country is very highly militarized, and I think we need to, you know, I think we need to move more in a more peaceful direction.
Okay, now, Don, it's 8:45.
Oh, it is 8:45?
It's 8:45 on the nose. Let our speaker call.
Okay.
I'm sorry to cut you off early, but let's get our speaker to get his closing remarks, and let's get on our way.
Okay. All right. I'm getting a lot of flack from the videographer who, now, in case any of you haven't figured it out already, the actual leader of the College of Complexes is our cameraman. So I will go forward to this speaker.
Oh, no, including remarks.
De facto leader.
No, Sergeant at Arms.
As concise as possible. I want to make it clear that we're talking about working in the outer world and the inner world. You have to have a society world filled with justice. You also have to have people who want to move towards that just world there. I also am thankful that some of you pointed out that the world is not just a bunch of crap. Because if we tell young people, we tell ourselves, we tell other people, just a litany of this terrible thing, this terrible thing, this terrible thing, this terrible thing, we're simply to close people down. So when we're talking about hearts and minds, or hearts, people need to also experience the joy of being alive. Okay, the joy of human existence there. Probably one of the best places where people are learning to live together is on, you know, music venues, on the dance floor. I have a son who is a musician. He plays at a lot of concerts there. There are black folk there. There are white folk there. There are red folk there. There are green folk there. There are Catholics there. There are Protestants there. There are Jews there. And people are just getting into the beat of their bodies, the beat of their heart, and they're learning that we can live together in peace. So I ask people to please point out, when you're trying to get people to bring about change, that there are a lot of events in human history in which change has occurred. Okay, and where people have stood out of the crowd, okay, and led us to a more peaceful and just world. Okay, that's it. We got to get out of here.
All right.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
We were a little.
Oh, yeah, that's a big one.